गुड इवनिंग डॉक्टर, आई एम ऑडिबल? या गुड इवनिंग डॉक्टर्स, टुडे वी हैव अवर यंग डायनामिक डॉक्टर जेपी शालिनी हु हैज पेंड एन आर्टिकल अबाउट कोमॉर्बिड कंडीशंस एग्जिस्टिंग अलोंग विद ऑटिज्म स्पेक्ट्रम डिसऑर्डर. शी हैज ए वेरी यंग डॉक्टर विद a PG in hospital management as well as an MBA. She has been in HR. Now she is working for a school, Akara school, where she is handling those proceedings. And it's already late, so I'm not getting into detail about her. Her work will speak her itself. So welcome, Dr. Shalini. You can start the session. All are waiting. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rekha ma'am. Before I start my session, I would like to thank you for providing me this platform and this audience. To be honest, without this team that we have made, this opportunity itself wouldn't have been there for most of us. It takes eons to build yourself up the ladder and to come forth and be on spotlight as a speaker. Thank you so much. I would like to welcome all the doctors and all the students and seniors to the webinar. I've just tried to make my version, my understanding of what is autism, its comorbid conditions, and how we would try to use homeopathy, on which all basis we can use homeopathy, how it can be helpful in this PPT and the webinar. So I shall start screening, sharing my screen. So can everyone see this? Is it visible to all, Dr. Rekha ma'am?
Yeah, it's visible. Okay, fine.
So, like, as the today's session is, it's scope of homeopathy in the treatment of comorbid conditions in autism. I'll be covering briefly ASD, autism spectrum disorders, ASD along with epilepsy, ASD along with Down syndrome, the ASD and comorbid conditions and its homeopathic management. The most of the session regarding autism and all in depth has been already dealt in our own team's webinars, but I would like to just give a small brief introduction. What is autism? We all know, most of us know, the symptoms. I'm just putting it into the most three things that we know primarily about autism. It is basically a developmental disorder characterized by difficulties of social interaction and communication. The child is not able to communicate properly. And the two more different key points is restricted and repetitive behavior. This is what strikes us in a small child. And as a parent, if we speak as a parent, then, and this is what the points are for a physician also to take note of. Autism is a highly variable neurodevelopment disorder. When you say neurodevelopment, it is self-explanatory in the word itself. There is some problem in the development of the nervous system. Now, this appears during infancy or childhood or prenatal. You know, pregnancy plays a huge role in that, which I know Dr. Ramya has covered extensively and beautifully in her webinar. So that's a point I'll be emphasizing here. Autism is something which has a lot of interconnective factors behind it. So one primary cause that we can say is pregnancy, since that's where it all originates. And later on we come to external factors, you know, the home atmosphere, the social factors, the genetic factors, which will all show as expression of autism starts showing itself during infancy, through childhood, and it usually has a steady course without a remission, if not much of the intervention has been introduced to that patient. Now, when we speak of autism, when we speak of why autism or where autism, what exactly is happening autism, there's nothing in particular that we can pinpoint on. there's different regions, several regions of brain which should together is making this involvement, whether it be a limbic system, temporal lobes, cerebellum, corpus callosum. Now, limbic system, we all know it is for emotional response, mood, and memory. What all things we hear, what all things we are seeing, the experience we are getting, everything gets stored there. Now, the temporal lobes, which we know are important for hearing and normal processing of sound, there's some mismatch or electrical imbalance there, or pathophysiological imbalance there, neurophysiological imbalance there, because of which we know that when autistic child, they have a problem with sounds, lights, sounds and all. They get very irritated when normal sounds or, you know, even day-to-day life sounds also make them agitated or restless. But the cerebellum, which coordinates the motor movements and some cognitive operation, there is some imbalance in that zone also. Corpus callosum, which connect the two hemispheres, two cortex together. Basically, it's a combination of all, and there's nothing in particular one cause that we can say which causes autism. Now, there are many theories, hypotheses of this, which I personally found interesting was while I was going through is that of amygdala and hippocampus. You all know amygdala is an almond-shaped part of the limbic system, which is specialized for input and processing of the emotion. Whatever emotion, whatever the experience is throwing on, whatever the situation is coming on, it's how we react. That particular aspect is by amygdala. And now how do we process that emotions in the next experience when we are faced with that particular situation or circumstance? That is done by hippocampus. Now these two are like best friends. So both of them will together, you know, have that communication to and fro going on, which is how it reacts. Basic communication process for any human, normal human being. So any during emotional reaction, these two brain regions interact to translate the emotion into particular outcomes. Now, for a child or for a person who is autistic, there is some imbalance. There is this communication which I had mentioned, the best friendship aspect of amygdala and hippocampus, is basically a cognitive flexibility, you know, to think what has happened, to understand, to learn, and now to react. This cognitive flexibility is lacking in autism. There have been few research which I have read, and the findings, what they have seen is, it's because amygdala and hippocampus, for the person who are affected with autism, are showing dense, packed neurons. And the size of these neurons are in particular smaller as compared to the normal person. Also, there have been a few studies which I went through for this thing, where they say that during the maturation stage for the amygdala and hippocampus, and for the autistic people, or for normal people in that say, it will grow. And after some particular type, it will be just stopped. The growth is not there. But there is this imbalance. They can't even specifically say that for this particular autistic person, amygdala has grown and has stopped, or hippocampus growth, or maturation has stopped.
Certain
situation, like for example, certain... I'm sorry, Dr. Rekhaman, could you please mute all the participants? Yeah, apart from me and you. Yeah, so I should continue. And in certain study group of patients, we have found that it is reverse also. So in particular, they have not any studies which I have gone through have mentioned that this is the particular thing that is happening for autistic person, and that is the bottom line. But I thought I would share this interesting thing to you all. We move on to our next session, that is comorbidity in autism. Of comorbidity in autism, let's see what is this autism spectrum disorder comes. This is the latest DSM, that is a diagnostic and statistical model of mental disorder. Under that fifth edition, they are mentioning only three falls under autism spectrum disorder. We all know, just for revision, autistic disorder, Asperger's disorder, pervasive development disorder, not otherwise specified, falls under this category. Now, this focuses on two core domains already I've covered, as I mentioned, is three, but under this article is Metro Light. It covers social communication impairment and restricted interests and repetitive behavior. If you talk about the prevalence of ASD, it's been increasing, unfortunately, the past two decades, with current estimates reaching up to 1 in 36 children. That is nearly 75% of ASD patients suffer from comorbid psychiatric illness or conditions. Now, I don't know how to quote it much, but with my experience, what I have understood is our whole social and economic as well as family structure has changed much from the past. Look into the past two decades. A lot of the factors that causes autism other than the genetic and more so often that we can see is because of our nuclear family system that we now follow. Eventually, if we see it's all pregnancy related, the prenatal thing plays a lot of role, and external factors plays a lot of role. The child, while being conceived by the mother, has faced a lot of depression or isolation or seclusion, which usually you don't see when, that's what I observed, when they were in a joint family. So this, maybe this small trip could in a way pave way for this growth that we see for this ASD or other mental conditions or other dependent conditions.